This is a motion picture studio 165 feet under the sea. These divers, wearing the compressed air aqualung, are true spacemen, swimming free as fish. To make this film, they roamed deep under the Mediterranean, the Red Sea, and the Indian Ocean, in a mysterious realm, the silent world. These are the divers of the Calypso, the research ship of the undersea explorer, Captain Cousteau.
Another dive is over. We have made thousands in the 20 years since our curiosity first led us underwater. Frédéric Dumas and I, after all this time, still think it is a privilege to go down again and live for a while inside the sea. And now we share this privilege with our friends of the Calypso team. The work on the station is finished. Albert Falco takes off his aqualung. Twelve divers, the Calypso, all our equipment, are in the service of scientific research. We carry parties of scientists from universities, museums, and laboratories. We use our techniques to study the mysteries of the ocean. Our new movie cameras were built by André Laban. He removes the mechanism from its plastic case to process the film of our last dive. François Saout, our skipper, who has sailed with me for 10 years, switches on the automatic pilot. The skipper plans the ship's course as well as our daily lives. We live in the golden age of undersea exploration, but free diving is not new. This engraving in my quarters shows divers wearing air bottles invented by an engineer named Freminet in 1784. For 100 years, the standard equipment was the helmet suit. Our friends of the deep, the sponge divers, still use it. We meet one of the Greek sponge boats which ply the Mediterranean from Gibraltar to the Golden Horn. Let's introduce ourselves underwater. In our galley, we have a hatch which allows divers to go down through the ship's bottom when the sea is too rough or the weather too cold. Dumas and Falco slip through the hull unseen by the Greeks. Down below, the helmet diver stumbles along on his leaden feet, a prisoner of his safety line and air pipe. Mm-hmm. these men dive as often as 10 or 12 times a day. Many sponge divers are killed every year, and many more are crippled by unnecessary dangers. The main peril is the bends. As a man descends in the sea, he encounters an additional atmosphere of pressure every 33 feet. To avoid being crushed, he must always breathe air at the same pressure as the water around him. Thus, nitrogen, the main element in the air we breathe, dissolves increasingly in his blood and tissues. When he starts up, the gas bubbles out exactly like champagne being uncorked. The bubbles block off veins and arteries, interfere with the nervous system, and may cause death. Even mild attacks in the joints can disable a man for life. Divers who ignore these physical laws may be crippled like this old man. We aqualung divers are subject to the same dangers, but we are better equipped to overcome them.
Prepare the decompression chamber, please. Now then, Laban, what is it?
I'm not sure. I have a funny pain right here in the knee.
Ah, and who were you diving with?
With Falco.
What happened down there, Albert?
Here are the troublemakers. Take them to the cook. I was going down to join Laban. He was looking for lobsters. And while I was chasing his air bubbles along the cliff, I saw him go partway down into a dark crevice. He'd found a spot that was crowded with lobsters. We'd already gone below 165 feet and hadn't reached the bottom of the cliff. We'd gotten to the depth where the air takes on a funny taste and you get drunk on your own breath. Suddenly, I hear a whistle from his air bottle. So I know his bottles are empty, and he's on his last 5 minutes of emergency air. He's a little drunk already because he's letting the lobsters go. But it wasn't serious yet. And then, all of a sudden, it becomes serious. He takes out his mouthpiece, and I realize he's lost his head from nitrogen narcosis. He's really drunk. I shove his mouthpiece back and send him up top. He seems to understand. I signaled him to decompress on the way up, but I should have gone with him instead of leaving him alone. His blood must have been loaded with nitrogen when he came out. And after that, you're surprised to have a pain in the knee.
All right, boy, into the chamber, and quick.
Do I have to, Captain?
Absolutely. Diving tables, please. Hello, Laban. You feel better now?
Yes, the pain's gone.
That's because we put you back under pressure.
How long do I have to stay in this coffin?
All right, boys, come and get it.
3 hours, according to the tables. The doctor will stay. I'm going to lunch. Hope you don't mind, Doc.
Hey! Hey, my lobsters!
Let's have some white wine.
Hey, don't think of
it. Oh, my lobsters.
You got any mayonnaise?
Yeah, the main is the beach. Just get these little bits out and they're wonderful. Bit of bread and butter.
We're approaching the tropics. Porpoises come to play around the bow. Porpoises are not fish, but warm-blooded mammals, a lot like dogs. They are intelligent and have a good sense of humor. They can outrun the fastest ship afloat. To watch the porpoises fooling around, Laban climbs down into the underwater observation chamber beneath the bow. Down there, you can hear them calling to each other in their little squeaky voices. It's holiday time among the porpoises, and they charge around us by the hundreds. We have never seen so many before. Night and day, the Calypso keeps a magic ear tuned to the ocean deeps. Our echo sounder bounces pings off the seafloor and records the depth on a continuous graph. The top line is the surface. And down here, the stylus draws the contour of the sea bottom. If you turn up the power, the stream of echoes reveals in midwater one or more mysterious layers. Scientists call them deep scattering layers. They have been found in all seas. Science has not yet established their origin. To try to solve the riddle, Professor Harold Edgerton has built for us automatic electronic flash cameras, which we have lowered over a mile down. The camera takes a flash picture every 15 seconds for 3 hours. We have taken over 25,000 such photographs beneath 2 oceans and 7 seas. The main layer is found at 1,300 feet, where whales dive to feed. The echo sounder clearly shows the camera going down into the layer. We stop the winch and let the camera soak for 3 hours, flashing in the blackness of the deep. We process the films on board. Most of the photos suggest starry skies. Others show jellyfish or weird colonies of tiny organisms, but the deep scattering layer still keeps its secret. The Calypso's scientists also use the classic instruments, such as the Nansen bottle. It is open at both ends and carries thermometers. At the chosen depth, a bronze messenger slides down the wire and traps the water sample. But no instrument can replace man. Divers are indispensable in a modern study of the sea. Dumas and Falco make a very deep dive with floodlights to survey the lowest cliffs of a coral reef. Down in the twilight zone, the last warm colors of sunlight fade into universal blue. 100 feet down, the divers switch on the lights and uncover colors which no man or fish had ever seen before. They often check their wrist depth gauges to establish the zones in which the different species live. The colors become warmer as they go deeper. Feet down, they enter the world of rapture, where compressed air steals a man's reason and the coral takes on nightmare shapes. Now we are 247 feet beneath the sea. This is the deepest shot ever taken by a cameraman. We must not stay here long. Our brains are fogged, and fatal dreams are coming. Up we go, our heads clear, and the beauty of the reef unrolls before the light. In order to take back a complete sampling of the reef, we must unfortunately cause some damage. In the coral gardens, there are beds of sea anemones with poisonous tentacles reaching to stun and devour little fish. But two fortunate species are immune to the deadly tentacles and even use them as a hideaway. This little yellow clown seems to be torn between fear and curiosity. Another odd animal is the sea squirt, which swallows sand, digesting what is edible and eliminating the rest. Its intestinal cavity provides shelter for living fish shaped like eels, firaspheres, which apparently have earned the right to come and go as they please. In the remote coral reefs, marine biologists sometimes use dynamite. Commercial fishing with dynamite is illegal, an act of vandalism. But for the purpose of scientific study, it is the only method for taking a census of all the varieties in an area. For every 10 fish killed, only one or two float to the surface. The rest sink with injured air bladders and only divers can collect them all. On the bottom, we swim into a tragic scene. When this pufferfish is in danger, he inflates himself with water, so the enemy can't swallow him. But the trick does not work against dynamite. The splendor of tropical fish does not last long out of the water. The colors fade even before the naturalist can sort them into his specimen jars. I have always dreamed of a way to explore long distances on the bottom without the heavy fatigue of swimming. So now we have the electric scooter. The diver steers with his whole body as he flies in space. You can park the scooter neatly when you spot something interesting. No parking problem down here. A sea turtle ride is a lot of fun, but they don't steer very well. Besides, the turtle must go up to breathe. Looks like the turtle is tired of this game. So let's catch a ride to the parking lot.
In 20 years of diving, we have explored hundreds of sunken ships. The wrecks that stick up above the surface have been looted or destroyed by the waves. There's nothing in them.
They are of no interest whatever. These half-submerged wrecks aren't worth anything. I've never seen one well preserved in less than 60 feet of water.
Munition ship went down in 1941 somewhere in the channel, in about 100 feet.
Few survivors, position badly indicated. Let's try to find it.
That's a bit like the story of a needle in a haystack. Maybe worthwhile. Have Lebon come here. Teixeira, turn on the echo sounder and the radar.
Hello, Lebon. Please come up here on the bridge.
Oh! Please make a radar target on the point of the reef. Put out an empty oil drum to give us a bright signal.
Okay, Captain.
Lower the white launch.
The ship must have gone down somewhere in this sector. We'll cover the area in a systematic way. All right, prepare a plotting sheet for ranges and bearings.
Grab it!
You'll be able to read your depth within 4 inches. The oil drum shows up right. All ahead, 1/3. Steer 050.
Aye, Captain.
Zero 060, 1 mile.
Something on the bottom. That's not our wreck, it's a school of fish.
Bearing 217, range 2200.
Change course to 150.
Uncle, take over the radar, will you?
I would try the underwater chamber.
Yeah, good idea.
Water clear?
Yes, quite.
Fine, I'll stand by.
Bearing 208, range 2500.
Position.
Bearing 211, range 2600.
There she is.
Dumas, see anything now?
Still nothing, but the water's changing color.
Reverse course to the left. Starboard engine ahead slow. Watch it now, Dumas. Look sharp. Fantail bridge. Stand by with the buoy. Falco and Puig, get ready. Here she is.
I see your mast.
Hello, Fantail. In you go.
Thistlegorm, Glasgow.
Thank you.
Calypso runs into bad weather. It is the southwest monsoon. For many days, we pitch and roll without relief. At last, the monsoon dies out, and we enter the equatorial calms. For 10 days on this deserted ocean, we have seen no land and no other ship, nothing but flying fish. Every night, dozens of them land on deck, attracted by our lights. In the morning, we simply pick them up for breakfast. They are very tasty. All day long, everyone aboard is watching for whales.
Look sharp, they're diving. Left, full rudder.
The whales seem to be enjoying a lazy promenade in the warm Indian Ocean. Here is a rare chance to observe them closely and film them from the underwater chamber. Saut rushes to the platform at the bow. He has never been so near to a whale in 30 years at sea. Now, under our skipper's nose, is a whale 60 feet long, and he can't resist having a crack at it. Of course, the homemade harpoon couldn't hurt the giant. Sperm whales are easy to tell from other species. Their blowhole is located on the left side of the head, and they make a slanting, misty spout. They can dive more than a half mile straight down. But today, they are just ambling along a few feet under the surface. They have teeth and live on squids and cuttlefish. You would think they had never seen a ship the way they let us approach so near. The Calypso rides among them for hours, and we study their behavior.
Hurry, right full rudder!
Right full rudder.
Thank you.
We've crashed into a whale. The Calypso shakes from stem to stern. The underwater chamber is dented, and the whale has the wind knocked out of it. I listen to its cries of distress. I can hardly believe my ears. The giant squeaks like a mouse. The water carries the cries far away, and from all quarters of the compass we see whales blowing. The entire herd is coming to its companion in trouble. The tribe gathers, bulls, cows, and calves. We are deeply moved by this demonstration of solidarity. Now there are 27 sperm whales just in front of the ship. Then, before our eyes, the drama becomes a tragedy. A baby whale, 20 feet long, falls behind the pack with childish carelessness. Look out, it's drifting right under the ship.
Bridge, engine room, bridge, engine room. Something has just stalled the port engine.
Start towing in as soon as possible.
The poor baby whale is heavily lacerated by our propeller. The cuts are so deep, it cannot survive. We speed up to harpoon it. We must put the whale out of its misery. Fights bravely to rejoin its parents. It keeps up with them for a while, but it is too weak and drops back from the herd. The baby cannot be saved. We all feel very bad about the little whale. Dumas gets his rifle and makes a merciful end to its suffering. We are not the only witnesses to this drama of the sea. The blood attracts a shark, then two, then three. Big and little sharks, gray sharks and blue shark. Where do they come from? There are 2.5 miles of water under our keel. The news has spread mysteriously in the deep. Soon, there are 30 sharks patrolling around the Calypso and the whale. For us divers, sharks are mortal enemies. We have met them often before, but never so many and none so hungry. It is time to put our anti-shark cage into action to protect the camera crew. I hope the cable will hold. So do they. This underwater dance of death has never been seen by any man who lived to tell the tale. A dead whale or a man in the sea, it is the same thing to sharks. They prowl round and round the whale for hours. The big ones are covered with clinging remoras, or suckerfish, and they are escorted by striped pilotfish. These scavengers share the shark's meals. The stowaways drop off as the circle closes. The sharks sniff the dead whale. They are very careful. But they are not so careful with the cage. Time after time, they bang into the bars, trying to get at the divers. Then comes the first bite. It is the signal for the orgy to begin. Every seaman hates the sharks. After what we have seen, the divers can't be held back. They grab gaffs, hooks, anything they can to avenge the whale. The chef takes the last victim, a suckerfish. sail away, completely exhausted. There isn't a breath of air. The heat flattens us to the deck. We have been sailing 2 weeks without sight of land.
Still no land? Okay.
On our first look around, it seems like the desert island of our dreams. It is a giant tortoise, which only survives on two islands on Earth. These prehistoric monsters are strict vegetarians. We'll be right back. nesting in the bushes, coconut crabs loaf in the sun. Footprints. Has an amphibious tank landed here? What made these tracks?
Hello there.
Good morning, sir.
What are you doing?
Me looking for eggs.
Eggs?
Yes, turtles from the sea, they come lay eggs in the sand. There is thousands and thousands round the island. It is mating season. Turtles come and gather in the bay two by two. At night, the females are climbing on the beach. The sand, it is still hot. They dig a nest, and then they dig a well for the eggs. Their hind legs, they are doing like spoon. That well, it must be very deep, or else the coconut crabs come and eat them eggs. Then the turtles begin laying. It is a very painful business, very long. More than 2 hours to put down all them eggs. When she has finished laying, she covered the nest with the sand. She caresses it gently, gently. And yet, perhaps never that turtle she will see her babies anymore. She is so tired that she can hardly get out of that nest. She can hardly crawl into the sea. Tears. There are people who say that it is the wind that makes them cry, but me keep thinking it is the sorrow. Pass and the sand begin to move everywhere. Baby turtles show their little heads. Oh, they know the way. They run straight into the sea.
Never before has a ship been moored on this lost coral reef. The fish in the neighborhood rush to see the intruders, and this is the way we appear to them through the surface. We will prove our peaceful intentions by bringing them food. Delmas cuts up meat for the first dive into the virgin reef. When he enters the water, the fish retreat. They are not sure of us, but we are very patient, moving without sudden gestures, trying to share this paradise with the fish. They hesitate a while before they accept us. Then, for 6 wonderful weeks, we are allowed to live among them. What is this strange relationship between the fat pufferfish and the jack? The puffer lives in coral caves, the jack is a raider of the open sea. Yet this is pure friendship. Can a man and a fish be as intimate? Delmas meets an 80-pound grouper who is very much interested in us. The grouper's teeth are small, but he has row after row of grinders extending from his mouth back into his throat. It could be pretty tough for us if he clamped on to our arm. Actually, the diver and the big fish are uneasy about each other until Delmas introduces the sack of meat. No, no, not the sack. Now the grouper has become a good friend. The divers call him Ulysses. Ulysses, may I have the next waltz? Ulysses never leaves us. When we go up and hang on the anchor cable to decompress, Ulysses comes along to keep us company. In 20 years of diving, I have never met such a familiar fish. The sack of food makes friends out of all the fish in the area. But Ulysses' appetite is insatiable. He is becoming a real nuisance. What'll we do? Now we have it. We decide to put him in jail. The anti-shark cage will do nicely. Thank you. Ulysses was very happy with us, but we must go. Adieu, Ulysses. We'll never forget you. The time has come to haul anchor, to leave our friends. We have merely skimmed the surface of the ocean. Someday, we will go much deeper to new discoveries waiting in the silent world.